video, you'll learn about two popular orchestration and pipelining projects, Apache Airflow and Kubeflow pipelines. We'll look at a practical, real-world use case of both of these frameworks and compare the two tools across a few dimensions. Please check out the video description if you'd like a more detailed explanation of each approach individually. There's one video link for Airflow and one video link for Kubeflow. Our review will cover dimensions like the tools ecosystem, the use of accelerators, the general development experience, and even the cost considerations. Now, we're going to specifically use Google Cloud as our example for the runtime with both Airflow and Kubeflow. So some of the points that we make will be specific to Google Cloud's managed version of these two projects, namely Cloud Composer for Airflow and Vertex AI for Kubeflow pipelines. That said, we'll try to highlight concepts that are true regardless of your specific environment. So let's first look at the ecosystem here. And by that, I mean how available are reusable components and libraries that take care of common data engineering or machine learning tasks. We can look at the Kubeflow pipelines example first, where we have a transcription task. We're running a conversion from MP4 to WAV to extract audio, and then we're transcribing that audio using the Google Cloud speech-to-text service. Now, overall, in this example, we had to write relatively custom components to be able to take care of these two pieces. For example, there's no component available for us to pull down that provides Google speech-to-text out of the box and in a turnkey way. We do have to write some Python code for that. So overall, our script here is relatively short, but it doesn't benefit from the reuse of publicly available published components. We benefit from the wide availability of Python SDKs and Docker images, but nothing more. This is somewhat reflective of the size of the community for these two projects. Compared to Airflow, the Kubeflow community is certainly smaller. Now, this is somewhat because Kubeflow is a much more recent project, having its initial release in 2018 versus Airflow, which had its initial release in 2015. But in any case, the current size of the community is definitely larger for Airflow. So if we switch over to the Airflow version of this transcription pipeline, we can see things like the use of Google Cloud providers for Airflow. We're going to be able to extend and use components quite nicely. Now, for this particular example, we're looking at a pretty similar amount of lines of code across both the Kubeflow and Airflow sides of things, but there are certainly more operators that are turnkey for using different services and APIs on the Airflow side. To capture the difference here, we'll say that Airflow's ecosystem is pretty well developed, meanwhile, Kubeflow's is more developing. On the next dimension of accelerators, this detail is very specific to the Google Cloud managed versions of these services. But on the Kubeflow side with Vertex AI pipelines, we can do things like adding accelerators using pretty familiar methods on our Kubeflow pipeline tasks, such as set accelerator type. Then you can have a specification of both the number and type of accelerators for GPUs or TPUs, which is really valuable, particularly for machine learning applications. On the Airflow side, though, unfortunately, Google Cloud's Cloud Composer does not support accelerator use. So you may have more success if you're running Airflow on your own, but right now, even if there's existing code to be able to support that, on an infrastructure layer, Cloud Composer does not support adding GPUs or TPUs. Now, let's talk about the development experience a little bit, and again, we'll look largely at the code for this. If we look at the Airflow side of things, there is certainly this kind of object orientation for operators and the different components that are provided by the Airflow providers. This may be familiar to some, but less familiar to others, and if you're extending operators in your code, this requires comfort with object-oriented programming concepts and can be a little bit difficult as far as the learning curve. Otherwise, though, the way that we define DAGs and have tasks is relatively intuitive, especially how the DAG is defined using these double caret annotations. This is a really intuitive way to build out the DAGs, and we can have rather complex flows here, including branching, fanning out, and fanning in. On the Kubeflow side of things, the components are relatively intuitive as far as defining the logic or the Python code that you want to run. However, the input and output arguments and the way that you handle artifacts with Kubeflow pipelines has a pretty steep learning curve. There are ways that Kubeflow pipelines are prescriptive around inputs and outputs and artifacts, and adapting to that prescriptive approach is somewhat challenging and a bit unintuitive. That said, once you figure that out and understand the ways to define flow in Kubeflow, it's relatively easy to construct the pipelines. I find the more sequential and imperative approach to defining the pipelines and task dependencies a little bit suboptimal in Kubeflow. It's much less obvious from this block of code here how the tasks relate to each other, and in that sense, I strongly prefer the Airflow approach for defining pipelines. So, in the development experience category, we'll say that Airflow's approach is a bit more extensive but capable, with an object-oriented development interface, whereas Kubeflow is a bit more focused but has a tough learning curve. Now, let's talk about the cost, and this is again going to be a very Google Cloud-focused analysis. If you're running these on your own infrastructure, your cost models are going to differ entirely. But if we look at the Kubeflow pipelines interface, we'll note that this is a serverless option for running your Kubeflow pipelines. We can just come in here, select pipelines, and then run them without setting up any kind of baseline system-level infrastructure or platform that we're paying for all the time. We have some configurability around, for example, the networking, so that this can run a little bit closer to our other software systems. But fundamentally, this is a managed service that's not provisioning VMs and incurs no management overhead. Meanwhile, if we go to the composer side for Apache Airflow, we're going to see that this involves static environment provisioning, at least to some extent, for the system workloads and the Airflow interface. Now, there are different sized environments, including the ability to run custom environment sizing on Composer, but even the small environment is still going to be a little bit over $300 per month typically, so this is a non-negligible cost just for running the system-level components. So certainly, when it comes to cost, Airflow is a medium-cost operation with auto-scaling, whereas Kubeflow is a low-cost option with serverless. We'll add just one more metric here, just as an added bonus, and look at the user interface for both of these systems. Now again, this is going to be somewhat specific to your implementation of these projects and how you're approaching the installation. But let's look at the interface for both. We're in Cloud Composer here, and I have an environment running. We can go to the Apache Airflow interface by clicking on the environment, and then clicking on the Open Airflow UI. This is a really extensive interface that includes a wide variety of logging, monitoring, as well as management and control interfaces. And this is just directly from the open source Apache Airflow project. If we want to go into a specific DAG run, I'll click on a recent one for our transcription example and then open up the specific DAG run. We'd see a view that looks like this, with slightly different styling for different operator types, and we can quickly see what's in progress, being retried, etc. There's a pretty wide variety of ways that we can view this DAG run, and we can also click into specific steps to see things like logs and the XCOM data across these tasks. Now, this is all supplemented by the Google Cloud interfaces, which have things like monitoring information and several interfaces to be able to view, understand, and analyze your environment natively in the Google console. This is also where we can provide things like PyPI packages for more customized Python workflows, and where we need to link out to things like, for example, where we're adding our DAG specifications. There are nice links here out to, for example, cloud storage. Now, let's contrast that with the Kubeflow experience. If we go into the pipelines here, and let's go into a successful run, We have this really nice and clean interface for our DAG, and this is easy to navigate even if we have pretty large DAGs with looping, fanning out, fanning in, and parallel branching structures. We can see our different nodes here, both for our processing nodes as well as our artifacts and importers, and see properties around them. Oftentimes, we'll be able to link to assets in Google Cloud Storage and see the kind of properties and configurations that surround a component, as well as view the logs and the job. Now, the job is essentially how the specific node is productionalized, including things like the CPU and GPU use, and the type of workers that were used to execute that task. So we get some infrastructure type details in these jobs, which maps to the nodes in our DAG. There's a little bit less flexibility as far as the state for these DAGs. We have passing, failing, pending, and also some specific icons around using caching for our DAGs, which can be a really nice performance optimization. So overall, this is definitely a much more focused and lean interface, far less extensive as far as the amount of controls and different views and consoles that we can use to observe these pipelines. Now, some of that is because this is a serverless approach to running your pipelines, whereas the Composer Apache Airflow system has some base system components that you need to maintain and manage, so there are some interfaces that necessarily need to be dedicated to that. But even beyond that, it seems like the approach for Vertex AI pipelines is certainly more lean and focused, which for most people can be really nice. Of course, this is somewhat up to personal preference, whether you prefer a more extensive or a more focused interface. As a last note to wrap up, I'll add that these systems have some light conceptual differences. Vertex AI pipelines are really focused on handling complex, heavy data engineering and machine learning workflows. In contrast, Composer is a bit more focused on orchestration. This is true of the underlying projects as well. In the case of Vertex AI pipelines, that would be Kubeflow, and in the case of Cloud Composer, that would be Apache Airflow. So each of these options can be better or worse depending on the use case, but also it is possible to use both at the same time. In the case of Cloud Composer and Vertex AI pipelines, it wouldn't be unusual for Cloud Composer to call a Vertex AI pipeline for some portion of the processing involved in a large and complex data engineering workflow, perhaps the pieces of the project that are more machine learning oriented, whereas the other way around would be very unusual. So really, you're going to have this direction: Cloud Composer calling sub-DAGs in Vertex AI pipelines. We hope this quick analysis was helpful, and we'll share the code for this like-for-like comparison in the video description. We'll also watch the comment section for any questions, and want to thank you for watching.